three. Now, I think Brandon referred to earlier to a book that I've written. Earlier. Called Black Marxism. A book which I appreciate Santiago likes, but has gotten me into a lot of trouble. And in fact, for decades, I appeared on right-wing blogs as a target. Been close encounters every now and then. I wrote Black Marxism for several reasons, but one of them was to try and contest the notion that freedom is the preserve of the privileged classes. The sensitivity, the impulse, the necessity of being free is unusual, unique. And in a sense, I was challenging the prerogatives built into Marxism. Because Marx really never explored the possibility that the Africans who were being treated as Slavs might develop notions of freedom, agendas for freedom, protocols for freedom, movements for freedom. Again, when I was a student, we knew very little about slave rebellion. In North America, in the Caribbean, in Latin America, and indeed, in an arena that Santiago is also concerned with, popular culture, the only slave rebellion which had been brought as a tribute to American films was Spartacus. An important film, useful film. But among the blacks, just as among the Irish, the notion of a noble rebellion was unacceptable, an intolerable notion. Now, these fragments of hatred, fear, terror, resistance against the impulses to freedom, these fragments don't disappear. Look at American 19th century humor magazines, and you'll see the Irish being depicted as apes. That was one of the clues that I took, that in effect, there had been indeed an appropriation of the hatred of Irish and extended to other peoples, including African peoples. Eventually, of course, the Academy began to change. It changed as a consequence of student rebelliousness. Not just simply black student rebelliousness, Asian student rebelliousness, etc. Around the death penalty, around Vietnam, around the invasion of Cuba, and so on and so forth. But in the midst of a year, 68, but hundreds of thousands of students in this country went into the corridors and the streets of the academy and raised questions about war, questions about academic exclusiveness, questions about the kind of injuries that many of them were suffering and encountering in their classrooms. So you recall at San Francisco State in 1968, and the campus that I'm on, University of California, Santa Barbara, also in 1968. Black students with cohorts from Asians and Latinos in San Francisco, with cohorts from white students in Santa Barbara, insisted that Black studies be established. And in 1968-69, those two campuses had got these programs. The impact of this was to, in effect, launch reinterrogations of the past, the long past as well as the short past. So things that we forbid knowledge, as one book describes it about the American war against the Filipinos, forbid knowledge began to surface, not as a consequence of dogma, not as a consequence of rant, cant, etc., but of research. And the few slave rebellions in North America that we had some sense of became, the numbers became expanded. And some explanation of how it was possible for people in the condition of being Slavs to imagine freedom became necessary. And that is one of the reasons why Black Marxism was written. There was no proletariat, there was no bourgeoisie. Marx had written, a Negro is a Negro. And as I've said to you, that's not true either. We can, in several historical moments and cultures, trace the invention of the Negro. So, it became necessary to try and wrestle with what theories would explain this new evidence, this new empirical base. The quilombos in Palmares and in Brazil. The nanny towns in Jamaica. The revolution in Haiti in 1791-1804, all of those required a new understanding of the world. Now let me take you to one study that complements Santiago's ventures in academia and intellectual and social movement history. In 1994, a professor at Emory published a book called The Conjuring Culture. His name is Theophilus Smith. So you know he's black. Right? One thing we don't do is name our children, well, you know, well, I don't want to say that. We're creative when we name our children. Anyway, Theophilus Smith produces a book in which he explores the Africanity of slave belief. Now, you know, most of you, the slave culture is difficult to find empirical evidence for, in the sense that one of the pieces of evidence that we had to rely on to a certain degree were the interviews of slaves, former slaves, in the 1930s. The WPA, the Works Project Administration, you remember that? Well, they did a lot of wonderful things during that period with respect to particularly the working class. But one of the things that was settled by the WPA was they were going to send investigators, interviewers, into those areas where people who had been born into slavery, remember slavery ends in 1865 legally, who had been born into slavery and who were still alive could recount their experiences. Now, this is 90 years. Almost all these people are 90 years old or older. The older ones had some adulthood in slavery, but most of the people who were being interviewed had been children during slavery. So this is the basic empirical record that we have of slave culture. Most of the other material that we had to rely on were travelogues, memoirs, and so on and so forth. And of course, there was the imitation slaves, the black-faced minstrels. And we had a better record of them than we had of the actual slaves themselves. But my point is this. On our campus, it was a football team, the blacks who were part of the football team, who revolted against their coach and occupied a building saying several things, demanding several things. Of course, they wanted to get rid of the coach. But they also said, look, you recruit blacks to play football, but not to play anthropology or chemistry. Why is that? Because we are strangers. We are strangers who have been inferiorized. You imagine us as those inferior Slavs who were never inferior, just simply victims. You imagine that we cannot wrestle with difficult questions. Any of you saw Lincoln by Spielberg? You know that the ending of slavery came as a consequence of the anguish of a patriarchal white man. No Harriet Beecher Stowe, no abolitionist movement, no Frederick Douglass, no slave revolts. Lincoln just got. So, as I said earlier, the occasion of the student rebellions deepened the academy in a way that it would not organically move. The academy continued to sponsor and produce racist texts, but now there was a resistance that was in your face. When I was at Michigan, University of Michigan, where I taught for 3 years, the faculty, the junior faculty got together and presented a program, a plan to the department to recruit black students as graduate students. We recruited 26 students, I think it was. But one of the students from Howard was Irish. But he was as black as everybody else. So here was a graduate program that had over 20 graduate students at one time. When I got to Santa Barbara, that was a total number of black graduate students on campus, not just one. All right. So I have to come to some conclusion. Black Marxism was an attempt to achieve a new understanding of how the slaves came to not simply imagine, but to articulate. We knew some things already. Higginbotham had said, when he had commanded black troops in the Civil War, Higginbotham had written a book about the songs the slaves or former slaves sang. Higginbotham said, you know, there wasn't a lot of attention paid to these songs by the ruling class. And in fact, most white people thought they were noise. They were noise. Wade in the water. Wade in the water. You know what that means? When you escape, when you're a fugitive, wade in the water. Dogs can't follow you. Go down, Moses. Tell old Pharaoh, let my people go. So the office myth in the conjuring culture began to investigate even further what indeed was emerging in the consciousness of these slave communities. I remember, we're not talking about the era of television, radio, mass communication. We're talking about the emergence of a culture which is largely a secret culture. A culture which has developed linguistic codes in which public speech can hide true meaning. If you're not a part of the culture, you can't hear. It's noise. So, Smith talks about an Afro-Hebraic culture. He looks at the slaves' employment of Genesis. He looks at the slaves' employment of the book of Exodus. He says there are indeed this extraordinary reappropriation, redefinition of the Old Testament and the New Testament. This is a conjuring culture, a culture that is inventing material out of foreign alien elements, material that is appropriate to it. So to a certain degree, black Marxism has to pay some attention to the meaning of the world in the imaginary of the slaves. A meaning that can produce not simply the desire, the impulse for freedom, but programs for freedom. Now, one of the other documents that we had was a document of a trial in 1831. 70 rebellious slaves in 1831, in August of 1831. As a consequence of miraculous events, eclipses of the sun, and so on and so forth, stage rebellion. And the leader is a man named Nat Turner. And Nat Turner is interviewed after he's captured. And the interview is published in 31 and later as the confessions of Nat Turner, or Nat Turner's confession. That would be like saying Plato's apology, Socrates' apology, is Socrates' confession. Because Nat is not confessing. He is prophesizing.
Great.
Nat says, when I was a child, my mother and my grandmother saw the scars on my body. And they read the meaning of these scars. They told this child that one day he would have this responsibility. In 1821, Nat became a fugitive. And after 30 days in the forest of visions, he returned to the plantation. In 1823, he had another series of visions. 1828, another series of visions. A conjuring culture. This is a program. A child is brought up to believe in freedom. And in 1831, as I said, as a consequence of an eclipse, the plan is put into operation. So in the confession, we have indeed a record of a manufacture of the invention of the rearing, of the breeding of one man who was a slave. So Smith tells us that indeed, this kind of charisma, remember charisma, the Greek, the gift, charisma is also the word from which Christ term Christ appears. The gift. So Gabriel Prosser in 1800 had the gift. Then Mark Bessie in 1827 had the gift. Nat Turner in 31 had the gift. John Brown in 55 had the gift. So the gift was not racial, it was cultural. It was not biological, because it could be learned by anyone. Learned by anyone. Give you an example. Some of you know about the Pentecostal movement. What came out of the Black Baptist movement? Black Baptist. So culture can be learned by anyone. So that is also an impulse of Black Marxism. The final impulse of Black Marxism in terms of the last three chapters of the book are an attempt to deal with those Black radical, rebellious, insurgent theorists who had to confront popular social movements which generated from the bottom up. And this is also one of the tasks that Santiago has undertaken. Santiago has written about C.L.R. James and the Haitian Revolution. James publishes this in 1938. What's helping? So, my understanding of James is coming to terms with this movement, which he maintains he can't really fully understand. Voodoo is the means of the revolution. That's something that Smith returns to in the countering culture. Revolution is magic. You understand it is magic. It is impossible. One Jamaican sociologist wrote a book about slavery called Slavery and Social Death. He maintained that the impulse of all slave systems is to destroy the language, the culture, the memory, the identity of the slave, to erase them. No slave system has ever achieved that. No slave system has ever achieved that. Why? Because we're dealing with human beings. Consciousness. The capacity to retrieve things that presumably no longer exist. Smith says, in the slave community, they remembered the beliefs of the Congo, K-O-N-G-O. They remembered the beliefs of the Yoruba. They remembered the beliefs of the Ibe. None of those people are Negro. They're Africans. And they took Christianity and transformed it from a religion of the word, and God said, to a religion of the act of the gesture. He smiled, God did, and light appeared. shook his head. And the stars appeared. So in the conjuring culture, part of the impulse in North America was to create things that were not there. Not there. It was not possible to end slavery. For a fifth of all the white males in this country in the 1860s were worth $100,000 or more by Southern white planters. The poor whites were arrayed appropriately as part of the militia of slavery. Clearly, when the Civil War and the secession broke out, the South, the Confederacy, was going to win. It had most of the military, had most of the arms. It was already a militarized society. 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, the Civil War. You see, because the slaves, as in Spielberg's imaginary, slaves are going to be passive. A war is breaking out, and they're backstepping. No. Most of the blacks who fought in the Civil War, 160,000, 180,000, 30,000 in the Navy, most of them were slaves. Not free blacks, most of them were slaves. So we come to that moment when it's important to review that indeed what Santiago has helped us to achieve is a global understanding of the way the past was in political and economic and cultural terms interwoven. Lincoln said at the beginnings of that war, I won't touch slavery. I will treat the Confederacy as if it never happened. It never went away. On the ground, colonels, captains, generals were saying, we can't do what you ordered, President, because what did Lincoln order? If the fugitives show up in your camp, escort them back to their plantations. Contraband. Field officers saying, you know, that doesn't make very good war policy. We return the labor to the enemy we're fighting. And some of them just won't go. And in fact, some places we've encountered, they've taken over. They've taken over. Because as we approach, the planters flee, the slaves don't go with them, the slaves now command the land. One last thing I wanted to say, and this is again kind of those factotums that is so often not realized. The historians talk about the Freedmen Bureau. Its official name was a Bureau of Freedmen, Refugees, and Abandoned Land. Slaves, the poor whites, and the land. that Spielberg never tells you is that at one moment the plan was to return the land to the slaves. The most radical democratic movement moment in American history. Most radical moment. But that is again another one of those hidden elements that we have to pay attention to. Thank you very much, and folks.